Yapılmak istenilen enerji kriziyle ilgili başta İsrail olmak üzere bazı devletler tatbikatlar yaptılar. Özellikle siber saldırılar ve beklenmedik doğa olaylarına karşı olabilecek ekonomik sorunlara karşı yapıldı bu tatbikatlar. Mesela son zamanlarda konuşulan şu solar patlamalar veya süper volkanlar gibi. Bunları kullanarak bir simülasyon tatbikatı oluşturdular. Bankaların kapanması, sisteminin çökmesi ve elektriğin gitmesi durumunda neler yapabileceklerini tartıştılar. Zaten bazı Yahudilerin inancına göre bekledikleri kral çöküşün ardından inşa süreci sonunda gelecek. Bundan dolayı bu süreçte dünya devletleri kendi iç meselelerine odaklanması isteniliyor. Yani devletler sınır savaşları, ekonomik krizler veya mülteci problemleri gibi problemlerle uğraşmalı ki İsrail istediği tapınağı inşa edebilsin. Zaten bu kaos sürecinde dünyadaki Yahudiler İsrail'e getirilmelidir. İlk 70 ve sonraki 7 yıllık sürecek süreç sonunda 3. tapınak inşa edilmeli. Yoksa bir sonraki 70 yıl beklenecek. Benim araştırdığım kadarıyla inançları bu yönde.
On December 6th, President Trump's words shook the world. He recognized Jerusalem as the capital of Israel.
The Temple Mount is the site of the first and second Jewish temples. But for hundreds of years, it's been occupied by Muslim shrines. The Al-Aqsa Mosque and the Golden Dome of the Rock now sit on the site. But some Jewish people want to build a third Jewish temple.
Temple being built in Israel. Do you believe that at all? I didn't ask you ahead of time, so maybe.
Well, yeah, I mean, certainly, and there's a push for that. And did you notice that one of the very first things when Trump was elected, the rabbis in Israel calling on him and Putin to use their international clout to do what? To rebuild the temple. Don't think this can't happen. I think impetus is on our side right now. I think we're moving towards a moment. And the rabbis over there, some of what the mystical rabbis are saying is very, very curious right now. Trump upset victory divinely sent to begin messianic process, say Israeli rabbis. Oddly enough, Trump goes to Israel in 2012, decides not to run for U.S. president, meets with heads of states, comes out of that, you can watch the YouTube on television, and he starts talking to the Jewish people, telling them to vote for Benjamin Netanyahu and the Likud party, which they did, right?
אז אני פעשה מה שהוא ומה הגיעתו.
ועושים.
הכניזה שהיא מסליק, כאילו שהיום כבר שעוד כמה שעוד בגיל ועדיין ריבו. אבל יש עוד כמה שעוד, אבל יש להשתדים גם היום. ובשורות טובות. זה שמחה וטוב לבות. אתה יודע שחסידים מתפילים שכל מיני מנהיגים את השמחה.
They're looking for a king. They're looking for a political leader. As a matter of fact, Messiah to them means the anointed one, and it goes back to the ancient days when they would anoint a king and recognize him as this is the man that God sent. They too believe that the Messiah is about to appear. We would say the second coming is about to happen, but their Messiah is going to be a false Messiah. He's going to be the Antichrist, right?
un scandale et de faire des pressions.
The whole financial system is heading for a collapse. We're also seeing instability in our governing institutions, setting the stage for global tyranny. There's a super dictator coming. The Bible's warned us about that.
There's a bit of a debate with the nature of the Antichrist. Is it going to come out of Europe or be a Middle Eastern figure?
The Muslim world, Allah, expecting a deliverer, the last Imam.
Some believe that global unity under a world government is the answer, where scientific advancements in technology and medicine might conceivably transform the world into a modern paradise.
Artificial intelligence will exceed the human intelligence.
Where everyone is plugged into this transhumanist technology, but there's a lie built into the system.
The steady encroachment of technology makes them so amenable to being probed, to being known about, to being followed and tracked, that can make them accept and believe things that are not true. We all buy into the same stuff, and we tend to think the way that stuff makes us think. And suddenly I realize there's a whole technology that's happened to me, and I didn't even know it. I wonder if we're even going to know when that point happened. Are we going to wake up some morning and say, wait a minute, I just got marked?
When we go down this road, we are opening a Pandora's box.
You are born again to damnation. It's some kind of an identification that changes one's nature.
Give someone a little implant which will alter their DNA.
Evil has this ability to represent itself as something good.
There is Lucifer behind the so-called collective state of consciousness of mankind.
Now, this is where it starts to get interesting. UFOs. There are events that are competently validated. Many people have heard so much nonsense, they just dismiss it as hallucinations or something. Those are people that haven't done their homework.
They're demonic. They have a hostile agenda.
Do you think the real God's going to put up with that for any length of time?
Unless Jesus returns soon, there may be nothing human to return to.
The father of the space age. Okay, now this guy who was at Cal Poly Tech, right? This guy, Jack Parsons, was openly a devil worshiper. He developed the fuel that enabled us to penetrate the stratosphere. Satellites could not have come about without this guy. In his diary that he himself wrote, he had a dream. This is 1948. He had a dream where he saw somebody that he calls Belial Dajjal. And he tells him, you are helping me. Where's all this stuff coming from? Where's it all coming from? We're in the age of the Dajjal, you know. It's just Allahu A'lam, when and where and what, but this is it, people. As far as I'm concerned, it's end game. Water and prayer and Qibla, can't take that away from us. So we need to prepare as much as we can, you know. But the technology, if you study where all this technology comes from, read about the magic and the Enlightenment period. All these scientists were magicians. They were all into black magic. You read about Francis Bacon. I just read a biography of Francis Bacon called Knowledge is Power, Magic and the Creation of Modern Science. Francis Bacon was reading all these magical books. Arthur C. Clarke, great technologist. He actually has most of the patents that enabled the satellites. Right? If you look at his interview with BBC in 1961, where he predicts the internet, he predicts the cell phones, he predicts texting. He said that by the year 2000, people are going to have handheld devices that enable them to talk to anybody anywhere, right? Arthur C. Clarke said, and he has three laws of technology. One of his laws is no technology reaches a level of complexity except it becomes indistinguishable from magic. I'm not a Luddite, right? I'm using a microphone right now. I'm not a Luddite, but this whole worshipful attitude towards technology to me is really stupid.
The 3 years preceding his appearance, there will be a famine on the earth. إِنَّ بَيْنَ يَدَيْهِ ثَلَاثَ سَنِينَ سَنَةٌ تُمْسِكُ السَّمَاءُ فِيهَا ثُلُثَا قَطْرِهَا وَالْأَرْضُ ثُلُثَا نَبَاتِهَا. That the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam says that 3 years before he appears there will be a famine, and the earth, all of its crops, there will not be a single drop of rain on the earth, and there will not be a single crop. Thus, the majority of the animals will die, and many people will also die. Meanwhile, the Muslim army will have just conquered Constantinople. They'll be on the verge of sharing the spoils of war between them. Whilst all of a sudden they will hear that the Dajjal has come out. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given the Dajjal extraordinary powers. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam has mentioned some of his fitnas. He will come to a group of people and he will call them towards a false religion. He will tell his people to call him God, to call him Allah, to call him the Creator, their Lord. And these people will believe in him. These people will call him Allah, they will call him their Lord. Because these people have believed in him, فَيَأْمُرُ السَّمَاءَ فَتُمْتِرْ وَالْأَرْضَ فَتُمْبِتْ. He will order the sky to pour rain, and the sky will pour rain. He will come to a group of people, he will tell these people to call him Allah, but these people will be the true believers, and these people will reject him, and they will not call him Allah, they will not call him their God, they will not call him their Creator. But the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, when these people, the true believers, have rejected him, when these people wake up in the morning, لَيْسَ فِي أَيْدِيهِمْ شَيْءٌ مِنْ أَمْوَالِهِمْ. These people will be penniless. Their property is gone. Their animals died. They will not have a single thing left inside their hands. This is why his fitna is the biggest fitna. The believers, the true believers who reject him, will have to suffer hardship. They will have to face and suffer difficulty and bear this difficulty. But the believers, the wrong believers, the ones that believe in Dajjal as their creator, they will live a life of luxury for a short while.
In the orthodox idea of when the Redeemer comes, if the Redeemer is the Goel, Mashiach, there's a bit of a sequence. Everybody goes to Jerusalem. All of those who have a share in the world to come go to Jerusalem, which is one of the reasons it has a huge holy status for Judaism in every age. And that includes those who have died. The King Messiah, because the Orthodox version of this has the Messiah as a man, very, very definitely. They've been announced. We know that they're coming. It happens. That transformation happens. Judaism becomes a Torah society. It is only ruled by Torah, by our religious commandments. And the rest of the nations accept God as the one God. There's a lot of a tradition in Judaism about be careful about speculating about this stuff too much, because that could divert you from doing the work that enables it to happen. Don't spend your time speculating about it, get on and be a decent person. And then that is eternity from then on, but it's a perfect eternity. The temple is restored, the temple sacrifices are restored. This, of course, is politically and practically extraordinarily difficult, but we're talking about a spiritual time. The world continues on, but at peace. The progressive Jewish idea of it is a journey towards this, that could you ever achieve it? It doesn't matter. This is where we're aiming for, and we're making the world better on the way there. And that, you could call it eschatology, that idea of this is what happens at the end of days, is not strongly there in progressive Judaism, because it's felt to be a diversion from good working and good feeling and good religious life now. There's also an idea of the Lamed Vavniks, which I love this idea. The idea of the Lamed Vavniks, so Lamed Vav is the Hebrew number system for the number 36. That at any time in the history of the world, there were 36 people, and could be men, could be women, could be anybody, who were around the world who could be the Messiah. There is something going on in some parts of the Jewish world that says the more chaos there is, the more likely it is for the Messianic age to dawn. And I think some of that is actually consolatory. It's how do you deal with living in difficult times? That's not there in progressive Judaism. In progressive Judaism, we, because of that sense of human mission in partnership with God, we don't want chaos because that doesn't get you there. But there are some parts of Judaism that say, well, chaos in the rest of the world, it's okay, although it's horrible to live through it, it may be the dawning of the Messianic age.
Kısacası, başta Orta Doğu kökenli İbrahim'i dinler olmak üzere birçok uzak doğu dini, hatta paganist öğretilerde bile bir kurtarıcının geleceğine ve krallığını kuracağına inanılır.
As from today, the Kali Yuga has started. It means brother and brothers is fighting. Friends and friends are fighting. You have kept a bad eye on the wife of your brother, or they have kept bad eye on the brother. That could never happen. In your eyes, the wife of your brother, if the brother is younger, it's equal to your mother. And if you're older, it's equal to your daughter, but they are looking in a completely different and corrupted way. That's where the Kali Yuga started. It will go through with when it reached the balance is tipped in favor of injustice, that will the end. I will reappear on them. And they predicted the name is Kalika, the final avatar of the God in the name of Kalika will appear. That's where that God has shown him his true nature. And he says, who are you? Well, he says, I'm a warrior. Then what is your duty as a warrior? He said, my duty as a warrior is to fight. So what he says, don't see as your brother or sister or anybody. You see as this is your job as a right person against the injustice. He's shown that end of the day, don't worry about it. Because I have realized you to say to you that not only you, they are part of me.
While all the books on the religion mentioned briefly the traditional hope in Buddha to come, no one felt that it deserved more than a passing notice. Messianism, however, has reappeared in contemporary Theravada Buddhism, especially in Burma. According to Buddhist scripture, Buddha predicted that at some future time, another Buddha would come to help men set up an ideal kingdom of righteousness and peace.
In terms of a savior, the Buddha really did not talk too much about a savior. There is one particular discourse in his vast discourses which are recorded and now available in texts, he mentioned about a savior.
People want somebody to come and rescue. But at the end of the day, you see, we have to also help ourselves. As they say, God helps those who help themselves. That's the old phrase. And that is where the helping ourselves is to do by doing good deeds. That we all have got the capacity to save the world. And this is why we have to do goodness. That in ourselves, we are all mini saviors.
Zoroastrians believe that the Saoxians will be a direct descendant of Prophet Zoroaster and will be miraculously preserved in the depths of the lake. When the end of time approaches, a virgin will bathe in this lake and through a miraculous conception bear a son named Asvatthreta, meaning he who embodies righteousness.
The world will experience three saviors who are posthumous sons of Zarathustra and you know, the seed of Zarathustra. And what the story goes is this, that every a thousand years sort of period, there will be a maiden going for a dip in one of the lakes which are not 100%, but somewhere in Afghanistan. It'll get impregnated by the seed and thereby with the virgin birth. So the savior is meant to come from a virgin birth. That is what the some of the Zoroastrian text says.
Today, we're taking a look at one of the fastest growing religions in the world, the Baha'i faith. There are now more than 100,000 Baha'i communities worldwide.
What we kept hearing to describe the Baha'i faith was unity. In Arabic, it means follower of glory. It was founded in 1844 in Iran, and the religion teaches the oneness of all world religions with principles that seem universal.
Well, that's a little bit of a misconception that the Baha'i faith is a mishmash, that we believe everything. We believe in this progressive revelation that the teachings of these great spiritual teachers, they all had their time and place. And so we embrace the religions that came before.
Krishna, all right.
Baha'is believe theirs is the religion of the future. Inside each temple, there's one dome, representing one God.
Be generous in your days of plenty.
At least twice a day, there are prayer services with readings from various world religions.
To achieve the highest level of understanding and spiritual perfection, Baha'u'llah taught his followers that human beings require training and education. That human spirit must be taught by educators who are manifestations of God, a phrase Baha'u'llah reserves for prophets. The manifestations of God are saviors and messiahs of mankind. The role played by them seeks to establish two things. First, to enable human beings to progress spiritually as individuals. And second, to promote the peace and advancement of human civilization. The savior in Baha'ism, then, is that the individual sent by God to liberate the children of men from the darkness of ignorance and to guide them to the light of true understanding. Here, the savior in Baha'ism, like that of Islam, plays a role of spiritual guide. In the social realm, Baha'ism holds that the savior helps bring peace and tranquility to a world filled with oppression and conflict. In Baha'ism, therefore, the savior is one who acts like a divine physician whose task is to foster the well-being of the world and its peoples, that through the spirit of unity they may heal the sickness of a divided humanity.
Bu konularda çok bilgi sahibi değilim. Yalnız bildiğim bir şey var, dünyaca ünlü istihbarat teşkilatlarının son derece detaylı bilgilere sahip olduğudur. Bu inançların tarihi süreçlerini, kitaplarda yazılan tüm detayları ve metafizik bağlantılarını çok iyi analiz etmişlerdir. Yani açık bir şekilde milyonların beklediği bir kişi ve o kişinin özelliklerini çok ama çok iyi biliyorlar. Örnek verecek olursam, özellikle Protestan evangelistlerin beklentisi olan Mesih'in tekrardan geri dönüşü ile ilgili Rus KGB'si birçok evangelist papazdan daha fazla bilgiye sahiptir. Ve çoğu Müslümanın özellikle Şiilerde yaygın olan son halife Mehdi inancı hakkında CIA ve Mossad birçok İslam önderinden veya Müslüman din adamlarından daha fazla derin bilgiye sahiptir. Keza Müslüman devletlerin istihbarat örgütleri de Yahudilerin beklediği son kral Meşiha hakkında detaylı bilgilere sahiptir. Zaten bu bilgilerin çoğu kitaplarda açık bir şekilde yazılmıştır. Araştıran herkes ulaşabilir. Burada demek istediğim şu. Bu kurtarıcı veya büyük lider, kahraman, kral, halife adına ne dersen de bu inançlar manipüleye çok açıktır. İnsanlar çok rahat bir şekilde bu kurtarıcı inancı üzerinden manipüle edilebilir. Özellikle insanların umudunun kalmadığı, zayıf düştüğü anlarda sahte bayrak yöntemiyle birilerini kullanarak çok rahat yapabilirler.
We Muslims have been told about this man who is called Dajjal, Ad-Dajjal, by our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam more than any other religion in the entire world. You know, every prophet that came to this world, they all spoke something about the Dajjal. But our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, who was the last prophet, he spoke about Ad-Dajjal more in detail than any other prophet that has ever spoken about it. Because he is the last messenger, and there is no other messenger or prophet after him. And he spoke about him in so much detail because the time for him to arise and walk on earth and do what he is going to do is very close. It is very close. There is a word for it today in the 21st century, and it's called deception. Dajjal means, the closest word I know of in English is deception. You know, when you watch stuff on Hollywood, that's what they do a lot of the times. If you have ever listened to music, and we all hear music wherever we go, music is playing, you know. Let's not lie to ourselves, music is everywhere, isn't it? But in the music there's also words and lyrics and things that the artists, the musicians do on stage and say that also is called deception. So what do they do? They show you things and sing things that sound nice, which makes it easier for you to believe because you get moved, right? You start moving to the beats, isn't that correct? And everybody else listens to it, and then you think, man, I'm gonna be left out. I better listen to this stuff, I better watch it. And you think it's cool, and it sounds nice, you know, because it's the shaitan's voice, really moves you. And what happens in there is that they take the opportunity to make you believe things that you're not supposed to believe. Do you know what I'm trying to say? I'm trying to say that there are things long time ago were not normal. In Norway, there's an article that I read that there are people protesting. They're going to the government to say if they can marry their pets. And there are others who are saying we want to legalize incest. Brothers and sisters marrying each other. Did you know that things are going to happen before the Dajjal comes? Listen to this hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. 1400 years ago, the Prophet, peace be upon him, said, the Dajjal, from the time of Adam till the end of time, this entire world, he said, there is no bigger trial, fitna, than the trial of Dajjal. Before the Dajjal can come, at the moment, the Dajjal is tied up somewhere. He's tied up somewhere. He's not allowed to come out yet. Do you know why? The ulama said, do you know why he's tied up for now? Because a road, a path is being prepared for him to come so that he can be accepted immediately. All right, and I'll tell you how he's going to be accepted and why, and it'll make sense inshallah. The Dajjal is the one-eyed, the liar, the deceiver. For him to deceive the people so good and to be the biggest trial, the people would have already been gotten used to deception already. I see Muslims themselves now today moving away from the real deen and making up their own beliefs. We see them all the time. Some of them, they say, you know, I think prayer is what you think prayer should be. They say, we only believe in what the Quran says, but we don't believe anything the Prophet, peace be upon him, said. They're called the Quraniyun, the Quranites. You know what they do? They bring you the verse about Salat, and they say, well, the Quran doesn't say exactly how to pray, so we get to make up the way we want to pray. But what I'm saying is, there is a time when even some people who dress like imams will make you believe in a different religion than Islam, and I will call it Islam. So it's deception. And the shaitan helps the Dajjal. When the Dajjal comes out, the world is ready for him, that the majority of the people of the world will follow him and believe him. Because in the social media today, social media world, isn't it a really fake world? So much filters, so many people who think that by getting so many likes that they're somehow important now. Like, the more stupid you do things, the more people give you likes and the more people copy you. And that's what's happening, right? Based on a few likes, and no one really cares. And that's Dajjal. That's all of it, right? This is all part of the Dajjal's, you know, coming.